This is Continuum Drag, a weekly podcast revisiting television sci-fi, fantasy, and everything in between. This week, The Lathe of Heaven.
George, I know that I can learn to harness your power, but you must give me time.
That's no use. We haven't got the right.
We have a duty. Why do you resist? Why do you fear your own power?
Because it doesn't work. You change one thing and everything changes. The plague didn't solve anything. We're closer to war now than we ever have been. I can't let you use me anymore.
Welcome to Continuum Drag, the podcast that gets by with a little help from its friends. I'm Luke, here with my co-host Jordan. What's real, Jordan?
I can tell you what's real with one word. Antwerp. I think that's a pretty good, I want to say safe word. It's not a safe word. It's a dream word. What would you call it?
I guess, yeah, a keyword that wakes you up from hypnosis.
Mm-hmm.
It was pretty good. I was also like, Antwerp, great. Don't say Antwerp enough in my life.
Antwerp.
Well, this week, we're going to get into a TV movie, but first, I got to say, we're joined by a guest today. Hilary, welcome to the show.
Hi, thank you for having me. I'm very excited.
Yeah, well, I'm excited to have you because this week we're doing a TV movie adaptation of an Ursula Le Guin story, The Lathe of Heaven. And I happen to know that you're somewhat of an Ursula K. Le Guin stan, perhaps?
I am. I watched, and I think at one point you called me an expert, which I am because I watched one documentary about her.
That's all it takes.
So, yeah.
This is why I know that, is because you watched that documentary. So now to me, you're the foremost authority.
I'm an expert. And actually, since we started talking about this, I did go and read The Wizard of Earthsea.
Oh, yeah.
Which is like probably her most famous book. And it's definitely a YA book. But I really enjoyed it as a 31-year-old.
Hey, I mean, there's nothing wrong with YA books. They're popular for a reason.
It's just nice to learn about wizards.
Jordan, you always say that, don't you?
Yeah, that's my autobiography title.
Well, before we get into the episode, though, I would like to know a little bit about your history or your personal preference toward television science fiction, since that's the theme of this podcast. Did you watch a lot, or are you a bit of a neophyte around TV sci-fi?
Certainly, I can't say I've watched a lot of like TV movies, which is what we're chatting about today. We watched a little bit of Star Trek when I was a kid. My dad is definitely a sci-fi man. So like we watched Star Wars a lot growing up. And as an adult, like I watched a bit of Battlestar Galactica and Doctor Who we watched.
Oh, whoa, Doctor Who. That's a place I haven't even gone to.
It's really good. I can't say I've seen all of it because that's crazy.
A lot of it.
But I watched the David Tennant seasons and the Matt Smith seasons, and they're wonderful.
This is the same sort of level of special effects, I think, The Lathe of Heaven and
totally.
And Doctor Who.
Yeah, and like, you know, we'll talk about this, I assume, but given the budget cuts, I don't think it's such a bad way to handle, you know, huge ideas just to be like, he's in a blue tube.
I agree.
Well, let's talk a little bit about it, because this movie was made in 1980, and I dug around a little bit, mostly on Wikipedia, of course.
Of course.
It was made by a PBS affiliate, WNET, in New York City as part of their experimental television lab. So this was part of a weird program they're doing to see if they could bring, I guess, sci-fi adaptations to TV, and the budget was $250,000. And that's, of course, in $1980. So I think I did the adjustment for inflation. I think it's about $600,000 today. So I was a little less impressed once I realized how much money it was today.
That's pretty small.
It's still pretty small budget for sure. And they make it go a long way. And they shot it in 2 weeks. So the fact that they pulled
this
quality together in that amount of time with that amount of money is very impressive. Though the directors, I guess, were a couple of video artists who came in to do it. So they came from an interesting background for visuals, which I think really is what helps make the budget stretch as far as it does. And just a little thing for Jordan here, because it was released January 9th, 1980. I guess Jordan and the listeners, of course. We can't forget about the listeners. But this came out 2 weeks before the premiere of a show we've watched before.
I'm going to guess Galactica 1980.
Dead on the money, my friend.
I'm going to argue this is much better than Galactica 1980.
It is funny to like pair these two ideas together, like one of the like most ambitious, smartest shows we've watched with one of the least ambitious, dumbest shows we've watched. Oh, dear. But yeah, why don't we get into it? Here's the IMDb summary for The Lathe of Heaven. In a highly controlled and overpopulated society, a man who has terrifying dreams that affect reality is assigned a psychiatrist who takes advantage of the situation. And that was courtesy of Chris Kirk.
Chris Kirk.
Thank you, Chris.
Yeah, thanks.
First person to ever thank our IMDb person. You're so polite.
He's not listening. He's dead. He may not be dead. I don't know if he's dead.
You imagine everything on IMDb is like ancient text.
Ancient text.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Well, the movie opens, I guess, as we sort of talked about with that video artist directors, it opens on a very like impressionistic montage of like sort of water that I felt a little bit like a sequence of space shots that like transitions into the sea roiling, then nuclear bombs exploding. And we then meet our protagonist, George Orr, as he kind of wanders the post-apocalyptic ruins of a city. And he quickly collapses and euphorically mutters yes. And we hard cut to this George Orr waking up from a bad dream in his near-future Portland, Oregon apartment.
What'd you guys think of that apartment?
I mean, it's not huge, but it could be worse.
I think it could be worse. I like that the cupboards in the future were exactly like cupboards, but they were just a little bit more angular. I was a big fan of that.
I'm going to tell you, I'm a big fan of that, too. That opening shot of his, like, tiny kitchenette with those weird angular cupboards and, like, just, like, one tiny appliance. It's like, oh, we're in the future. Look how small everything is. And then they turn the camera around, but the entire apartment's like cracked and water damaged. And you're like, oh, he has a shitty apartment in the future. I thought the set design really established the world I was in like 8 seconds in a way that I'm just like, wow, good job, everybody.
And I think it's 2002, right?
Oh, did you catch a date?
I don't know if that's clear in the film, but yeah.
I think the book, it says the near future. So maybe in the book it is right, 2002.
In the book it's 2002, which is interesting, because and the other like number fact that is just part of what happens when you try and set something in the near future is the population of the world I think is 7 billion, which is like unlivable.
Like, 7 billion people, can you imagine?
Yeah, exactly.
But yes, he's in this rundown apartment in the future. It's always raining here in Portland. And very overpopulated is what we're supposed to... We get in this sort of first few moments here of this near future that is very much not a dystopia, because it seems to be functioning okay, but like certainly not the best place to live, perhaps. Mm-hmm. And George, of course, is going to go see, and let me see if I can pronounce this word, honorologist, I guess a psychiatrist who specializes in dreams?
That sounds good to me.
Yeah, right? They're pretty close.
Yeah.
And he's going to see the psychiatrist because he's required to do voluntary therapy after attempting suicide and getting charged for scamming the auto pharmacy to get the drugs for the attempt. So he's on probation, and his probation is, you need some therapy, my friend.
As soon as he goes to see his therapist, which we're going to meet in the next scene, does the therapist offer him cigarettes, right?
Yeah.
And I just want to see if you both caught this. He offers him cigarettes, and he goes, no, I don't like Triggs or D-Nigs. Is that what he said?
I think he said he had two kinds of cigarettes with different tips. One was a Trank.
Oh, a Trank. Okay.
Yeah.
And the other one was like a non-nic, I think. So it had no nicotine or something.
Oh.
I also caught that. I'm just like, oh, fancy cigarettes in the future. Yeah. But thankfully, we know he's a hero because he doesn't smoke.
Yeah. I'm not a smoker, but when you offer someone else a cigarette, do you often offer two types of cigarettes?
If you're a good host, you do.
I guess.
Do you want a De Maurier, or are you more of an American Spirit man?
There you go.
I know all the
you
kinds
could think
of
two kinds of cigarettes.
I know, right? Yeah. Pretty good. But yes, this therapist he's going to meet is Dr. William Haber. He seems like a very basic psychiatrist. He seems very much to want to help old George here. And George sort of explains to himself he attempted suicide to stop the dreams he's having. Because as they sort of start calling them very quickly there, George believes he has affective dreaming, which is essentially when he dreams, his dreams rewrite reality and no one notices but him.
Yeah, it doesn't only alter what's happening now, it alters the past, so what he has changed has always been.
Yeah, it's a very, I was just like, oh, I don't think I've seen this ever as a series before, or a show, like, a man who changes reality with his thoughts. Mm-hmm. And sort of to explain this, he explains this, it started at 16 years old, and he goes into this very grim backstory, which, wow, a lot going on here, but his aunt got a divorce and moved in with his family. And while she was there, she'd always, like, joke around and kind of, like, flirt with a young George, I guess, as, like, because she's newly divorced, I guess. So one night, being a 16-year-old, he made a very aggressive pass at his aunt.
Yeah.
He tried to cop a feel.
This is super interesting to me in that the book is very close to this. Like, Ursula was listed as a creative consultant, and it shows. Like, it's a very, very faithful adaptation. And there were only a couple minutes where I was like, oh, that's kind of an interesting change. And this is one of them in that in the book, it's very explicit from George that his aunt is coming onto him.
Right.
And, like, his aunt is kind of looking to abuse him, and he is afraid of her.
I thought that's where it was going to. I thought she was the aggressor, but when they do this thing where he makes the pass.
This is a very interesting change to make.
Really, cops a feel and then gets slapped, and I'm just like, oh, wow, what a grim beginning to this man's life.
I think it would have seemed creepier, though, if they had had a younger actor playing the part, because I think the star, what's his name, Bruce Davison, he's probably, I would say at this point, he's probably in his early 20s, right? Mid-20s, the actor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So when he's playing a 17-year-old, he still looks like a guy in his mid-20s. It's not like, it doesn't seem that creepy, but if he was, like, you know, actually 16 years old, and I don't know, maybe it would seem a little worse. Innocent hijinks.
Jordan's just like, this is just growing up.
just a light incest.
Yeah.
But yes, he's slapped by his aunt, and he goes to bed. And that night he tells the psychiatrist he dreamed that his aunt was in a car accident. And when he woke in the morning, his mother received a letter that his aunt was killed in a car accident in L.A., and had never, in fact, moved in with him after her divorce. So this is his first instance of waking up, finding out no one has any recollection of his aunt moving in with them, mm-hmm. and now she's been killed, and his effective dreaming basically rewrote reality to prevent her from coming into their lives.
This raised a question, and this might be for you, Hilary, as the resident expert Ursula Le Guin. This is the first dream where we're going to get several dreams as this goes on, and they're all sort of presented in a, I don't know, slightly symbolic, esoteric kind of way. Mm-hmm. Is that how they were in the book? Because I think it's actually an effective way in this movie to show something without having to show it, because obviously the dreams start getting bigger and the ideas of what they're changing are bigger, so they sort of keep them symbolic and you find out later what the result is. Is that how it was in the book?
It is, and it sort of isn't, in that in the book we stay with Haber during the dream sequences, so we don't go into George's mind. We just see Haber and what's happening in his reality. But he does often ask George when he wakes up, what did you dream of? And it is that sort of, like, I think, not to jump ahead, but in one of these he mentions he's having, like, a picnic with Genghis Khan. And there's, in the book, he sees the horse and Haber and JFK.
Right, right, right.
So there will be just sort of, like, little elements that he interprets in a different way. But yeah, I think they did a good job of visualizing it.
Yeah, I mean, the dream sequences are very much kind of that, like, dream logic. You're only getting glimpses of things. And, like, they're very evocative, but you don't really know what they're going to change till you kind of get that moment when he wakes up. Mm-hmm. Of course, right now, he's telling Dr. Haber the story. And Dr. Haber, of course, doesn't really believe the idea that he has effective dreaming. He believes he's probably some sort of schizophrenic. I believe he writes in his notes, possible schizophrenic.
Yeah.
But Dr. Haber, as a dream doctor, he's built himself a device that he seems to have cobbled together from a variety of, like, monitoring items. It's fun. It's like that weird, like, mad scientist sort of setup he has in his lab. But basically, he's going to put George to sleep and monitors REM sleep to see if he sees anything unusual going on during that. And to do that, he'll need to hypnotize him to suggest a dream. But Dr. Haber has perhaps the most aggressive form of hypnosis I've ever seen performed.
Yeah, so in the book they touch on this a little bit too, which is that George is a bit resistant to hypnosis, and that normally, I think they mention it too in the film, that he's like, they're pressed for time. So it's a faster way to hypnotize somebody. It's essentially like grabbing their throat, I guess.
Yeah, it's hypnosis by chokehold.
Yeah, exactly.
He's very good at it, though. Every time he does it, he doesn't like it. It would be awkward if he went to grab your throat and then just squeezed it and choked you a little bit. And he's like, oh, sorry, I was just trying to knock you out. And then he did it again. But he's effective 100% every time. He grabs you by the throat. You're in a dream state.
You're out.
Yeah. And it's like a UFC move or something. It's like you get punched in the throat suddenly and you're like, you're under hypnosis. It's over. Made me laugh so much. But anyway, while he's under hypnosis, he basically suggests to George a dream he should have so he can monitor his sleep while he has a dream. And as you mentioned, Hilary, the first dream he suggests is to just have a dream about a horse. Just a horse having a nice time. And, you know, we get a little dream sequence where we see a horse running through a field in a city and in a paddock. And when George wakes up, he looks at the wall of Dr. Haber's office, and what was a picture of Mount Hood has now become a picture of a horse, or more specifically, the Triple Crown winner, Tammany Hall, three-time winner.
Everyone knows this.
And when he says, oh, you changed that picture while I was asleep, is that part of this therapy? And the doctor, of course, is just like, what are you talking about? I've always had a picture of that horse on my wall. It's never not been there.
Did you notice the other small change that had happened? I mean, obviously, as things go, things start changing more and more. But after this first dream, the doctor's sweater changed from a gray sweater to a cream sweater.
I missed that.
And I like that it didn't even get that much better. It was just like, you know what? This color is a little bit better for him.
That's really good, though. I really like the idea. It's like, there were some subtle changes.
Yeah. The first dream, just a little bit. It's like, this cuts better on you.
And of course, George, you know, he's stuck in this for court therapy. So he returns the next day for a second round of this hypno-dream therapy. This time, Dr. Haber suggests a new dream. He's just like, hey, it can be really rainy and smoggy here in Portland. So why don't you have a beautiful dream about a nice day so we can like improve your mood a little bit. However, this time when Dr. Haber has him under, he notices his equipment's giving a bit of a weird reading. I believe the little brain on one of the screens starts flashing red. He's like, that's weird. The brain shouldn't be flashing red.
Well, everything should be blue. That's how in this movie, you know, everything's going well. Mm-hmm. It's all blue color. So if anything but blue, there's trouble.
You're in trouble now.
Yeah.
And Dr. Haber races up to the roof of his building where he witnesses the clouds parting and the sun coming out and the basically weather clearing up miraculously. And as he returns to his office to wake George, he stops by his receptionist desk and asks her to call Portland weather just to get a little sense of this. And this is where he hears from the Portland weather's automated greeting that this is Portland, the Sunshine City, and that it's never rained here in the last 2 years. And this is kind of, I guess, the moment we're supposed to understand perhaps Haber is noticing reality has changed.
This is one of my favorite moments in the costuming, in that did you notice that his receptionist was in pants before?
Yeah.
And now she's in that cute little short suit? Mm-hmm.
You guys are so good. I missed all of this.
Because it's sunny now, and Haber sort of reacts to her like he's never known that she had legs before. Like, when he sees her, he's like, whoa.
He's like, oh, wow, I'm glad I hired you.
Yeah. I couldn't tell when you had pants on that you were a woman.
You look like a man. Ugh. Yeah. I had a question, though, and this is something that's going to come up, obviously, later on. Is it explained in the book why anyone who seems to be in the room with George has a memory of the past as it was before the change happened? Because I'm assuming all of the other citizens of the city or the state or the world or whatever it is have no memory of this, right?
Yeah, that's the understanding of it, is that George is the only one who remembers, but because Haber is there with him at the moment of the change, then he also has a memory of it. And it is a little bit more explicit in the book that you get, because there's not a ton of dialogue in the book. Like, a lot of this is internal. And you get Haber's reaction when he sees the picture of the horse, that he's like, shit.
Oh, really?
Is it a horse? Yeah. Like, he does have a moment of like, wait a minute, is that right? But it's sort of harder for him to accept it. So there's sort of a period in the book where you're not really sure if Haber believes him or not.
So if the secretary had been in the room and Haber was out of the room, he would have come in wearing shorts and she would have been like, check the gams on Haber.
Whoa. Exactly.
But yeah, I mean, I guess that's it. This is the moment where he starts noticing something really is going on, like effective dreaming seems to actually be happening. It's very interesting. Like, he very quickly formulates, like, this is a very powerful thing. And he very quickly, we get a clear idea that he is like, I'm going to need to use this power basically to correct everything wrong with the Earth. Like, he wants to save humanity, save the Earth from its current trajectory. And he sees George as the conduit to do that. I mean, this is the, I think that, you know, it's not a subtle book necessarily, but it's kind of becomes about, this movie is about his hubris to, like, make grand changes on a scale and how they work or don't work out, as that may, case may be. But this is kind of the moment when I think this occurs to him. Like, he keys in to the opportunity immediately. This man is just like, I see a chance, I'm going to take it.
Absolutely.
He's a real entrepreneur.
Yeah, I think, like, Elon Musk is a good way to think of him. Right. Like, it's like somebody who started with really good intentions and maybe got a little lost along the way.
His office keeps getting better, though. I wrote it down now as it's future fancy.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, that's just it. He wakes George up and Dr. Haber basically pretends like nothing's changed. He's going to spend like a portion of this movie just gaslighting George into like pretending he doesn't remember that anything's changed. But George does when George gets on a tram to go home. And on the tram home, he hears these two women complaining about all the sunshine now and how much they hate it. And it occurs to him at this moment, he's like, wait, Dr. Haber said something that makes me think he maybe realizes more than he's saying. And so we get this idea that George is perhaps on to Dr. Haber, and that Dr. Haber may be attempting to use him to his own benefit. And to this end, George goes to see a civil liberties lawyer, which I thought was, like, fantastic. I'm just like, here's a man who's worried his effective dreaming that changed reality is going to be abused by his psychiatrist, which really is a violation of his civil liberties. I should see a lawyer about this.
Yeah, it's, and, like, at least in the book, it's explicitly the ACLU. Like, it's like, we never exist in a continuum where you don't go to the ACLU when you need a good lawyer.
It was, I actually kind of liked it, because there's a whole bunch of little things in the world building here about, like, he has to sign a consent form to get hypnosis. There's, like, this real idea that there are checks and measures in this world that, like, Haber has to, like, deal with, which is just such an odd, you don't usually in these movies or that we watch, it's like, the military is the only solution. And this one is just like, you got to get yourself a good civil liberties lawyer, because your court-appointed psychiatrist is probably abusing you, and you should probably be appointed a new psychiatrist, because this is an unethical man. So the only opportunity is to go see a lawyer. And this is Heather Lalosh, I believe is her name. And she'll be basically the third character in this. And she's obviously a little skeptical, but she's a good person there to protect people's rights. So she's going to start looking into it. And of course, George still has to go to therapy in the meantime. And this is on his third trip in, Dr. Haber, having slightly changed the world into being sunnier and having a horse picture on his wall, just like puts the pedal to the metal and's like, this time when you, my suggested dream is, what if I had a cool dream therapy institute that's like 7 stories tall and I was a very wealthy, powerful man? How about that dream? Mm-hmm. And when George wakes up, he's got a great new office.
Which also is like a beautiful set. Whatever that building is, gorgeous.
The location choices in this movie are fantastic. They did an amazing job.
Yeah, well, I mean, we should say the whole city is that very, it's the futuristic look, but it's that sort of brutalist architecture. Everything's very angular with small windows and odd shapes. But I did think, to both your point, all the sets look great because they're clearly real locations. So they have a really just big, spacious, empty lobby that they can have conversations in and things. And everything seems very open and slightly futuristic, as seen from 1980.
Yeah, very much so. I did like this too, when George wakes up and he's in this like brand new, like fancy office, and like Dr. Haber's having to still pretend like he's like, doesn't notice the changes. But like that actor's face is great, because he's just like looking around. He's like, holy crap, I really scored big this time. Gotta play it down though, so George doesn't know.
He doesn't get to give his opinion though on how things get decorated. You know what I mean? Like, he's like, I hope it's better. He's like, oh, thank God they put that wall with knobs and tubes on it.
I mean, and Dr. Haber is not a self-serving. He doesn't really want to be a self-serving man, because he builds himself an institute with great influence in this dream. But he also gives George something he's always wanted, a cabin by the ocean.
Yeah, George's desires are a lot simpler, I guess. And that's how we understand he's a good man. Like, he doesn't want to rule the world. He just would like to have a cottage he could go to sometimes.
The thing about his cottage, I noticed that, like, it's not even just, like, a solitary cottage on this, like, beautiful coast or anything. It's, like, a cottage with, like, 15 other cottages. I'm like, man, it's going to stop being fun real fast when those annoying neighbors come by.
I did. This was great, though. This George's only dream is this cottage. And when he wakes up from this dream, he's like, I won a cottage from the government lottery. But it's at this point that the lawyer, Lash, she comes back around. She's basically come up with a plan to see, sort of like look into whether George is being abused by his therapist. And basically she's going to, when she finds out that Dr. Hayward's been using kind of an experimental treatment machine during their therapy sessions, this is at least enough cause for her to come in as an observer for the state just to see, like, make sure this experimental treatment is ethical kind of thing. So her plan is she'll show up to his next therapy session as an observer for, I guess, the health department or some sort of government agency, just to sort of gather evidence on George's behalf to see if anything unethical is happening in these therapy sequences. She doesn't believe in effective dreaming, despite the fact she's going to the fanciest, like, she doesn't realize his office has become the fanciest thing on earth. But and so we get to this next sort of therapy session where, of course, Haber's annoyed that he has an observer to see his, what is he called? The dream augmentation device he's built. But regulations are regulations. And they have this really funny tête-à-tête here, Lash and Lalash and Haber. And I'm just going to give you one quote because I just thought this quote was, like, very funny to me for some reason. Haber's talking about psychiatric medicine. He's just like, his quote is, neurotics build castles in the sky. Psychotics live in them. And Lalash retorts, and psychiatrists collect the rent.
I liked that too.
Like, yeah, you slap down Haber. You slap him right down.
It's how we know she's feisty.
That's true. She's very feisty. But in this dream sequence, George is strapped into his typical hypnosis therapy. And the suggested dream today is that he do something about solving overpopulation in the world. And this is a cool dream sequence, actually. He dreams that himself, Haber, and Lalash are at this long dinner table just full of people having a nice, like, fancy dinner. And as the dream continues, they start getting covered in, like, people at the table start getting covered in shrouds and cobwebs start appearing. And there's this, like, very ominous feel to it with a door opening and light glowing in. But I wasn't sure kind of how it was going to pan out. And when he wakes from the dream, he immediately realizes a plague wiped out 6 billion people on Earth 5 years ago.
Yeah, it's a big one. It's probably his biggest one.
I gotta say, I was just like, whoa, Haber, you're just moving on this. You just killed 6 billion people.
I'm gonna defend Haber, though. Silver lining, less traffic.
It works out pretty well for everybody, but I think it also speaks to, like, Haber doesn't say to him, kill 6 billion people. He says, do something about overpopulation. And then how it pans out is how it pans out. Like, I don't think he thinks going into it that that's exactly what's going to happen.
Absolutely. And I mean, that becomes part of Haber's thing, too, is that George's subconscious is an imperfect device to, like, attempt these changes because you don't know how he's going to interpret your suggestion every time. And this time you kill 6 billion people.
Yeah.
Although I'm going to say he could try to be a little bit more specific. It should be like, OK, we're going to do world peace, but not with aliens.
But of course, because Lalash was here sort of monitoring this session, which I thought was one of the best moments of someone having this realization, is we get to watch her have the actress deal with two conflicting memories, a memory of a world with 6 billion people and a world where a massive tragedy struck five years ago. And Lalash is just, like, devastated by this. And she basically has to leave the room because, like, she's got these two conflicting ideas of what has happened in this world. And we get to see kind of this new world outside. It was great. They, you know, in that first sort of 15 minutes of the movie, they do a great job with lots of extras. It's really overpopulated. So when you step outside into this, like, devastated world, it feels so empty. And they did such a great job of, like, creating this dichotomy of this reality change.
Yeah, there's a good scene, too, where I don't know if it's when she goes to see him or it's just a establishing shot, but there's a shot of the building he's now living in because he's now living in a nicer place. I don't know if it's the building has gotten better or he's in a better place, but you only see his name and one other person's listed on the directory. And I thought that was a good, quick way of showing there's very few people in this building now.
Yeah.
It's very well done. And I mean, kind of what happens from here is Dr. Haber's still playing dumb about whether he realizes what's happening or not. But, you know, George is pretty suspicious and they kind of do finally have a confrontation about, like, are you doing this on purpose? And Dr. Haber comes clean finally, just like, I'm trying to solve society's problems. She doesn't quite apologize for gaslighting him, but like, yeah. I'm trying to fix things, and this is what we're doing together. Like, we're a team. And as George points out, he's like, we've alleviated, you know, overpopulation, but the world's not better. Like, we're closer to war than we've ever been in this planet. Like, these dreams aren't working. But, you know, Dr. Haber's not
phased.
Yeah, he's not going to stop. He basically, when they're having this confrontation, he, like, chokehold hypnotizes him in the hallway. Like,
yes.
A forced hypnotism in the hallway. And they're going to give it the old college try one more time. And this time, the suggested dream is, hey, what about peace on Earth and no more war?
Mm-hmm.
Which, of course, George proceeds to have a dream about aliens invading the moon and Earth uniting against the aliens.
I thought of all the visual effects. This is probably the one that has aged the worst of the,
for sure.
I don't know what it is, the superimposing of these sort of like light alien ships flying around. It doesn't look great, but I mean, it is what it is for this show.
I mean, yeah, it's probably, you know, the more difficult pull. They have to show it basically in his dream, aliens invading the moon. And mm-hmm. Yeah, it's mostly like light effects, like flashing on the moon. We do get to see like a brief shot of what one of these aliens looks like, which I like the design of. They look a little bit...
It looks like a turtle with a glowing head.
Mm-hmm. That's how they're described.
Oh.
Is they're in these turtle suits.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of, to me, it reminded me a little bit of, do you remember the engineer, the navigator alien from Aliens 1? It's like the dead creature they find inside of the ship. Like, it looks a little Geiger-esque. Mm-hmm. It very much looks like the alien in that, like, chair, mm-hmm. if that's a movie you remember.
And the aliens all have nice, soft, dulcet tones to their voice.
Yeah, and this, we can talk more about this, but I think with the aliens, you get the suggestion that because Orr has brought them into the world, they have this connection.
Right.
And because Orr is our man, we kind of like the aliens because Orr likes them.
That question is raised in the movie, too. It's just like, I believe George says, he's like, what did you drag out of the deepest recesses of my mind to invade the moon? He's just like, mm-hmm. if this stuff only happens because I dream it, it's just like, what kind of freaky monsters did I just dream up?
Which, and it makes sense, right, that they'd be in these turtle suits because it's something that the human mind can imagine.
That's true. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I thought it was kind of fun, these little turtle suits. But at any rate, when he wakes up, George, Dr. Haber is furious that the best way he could think of world peace was to have aliens invade the moon. Dr. Haber could not be less happy with how George interprets his message.
I think it's good if you look at from Haber's perspective, he's like, I'm doing all the work here. I'm coming up with these ideas. I'm trying to solve problems, and you're ruining it with your superpower.
It's true. It's your fault, not my fault. I have great ideas.
Yeah. I said peace on Earth. I didn't say turtle aliens.
And I gotta say, like, I'm not sure what the time code is at this point in this movie, but this is still like mid-second act, and I'm like, the world has now been invaded. Like the movie, like so much changes so quickly in these dreams. Like we're mm-hmm. on dream four, and there are now aliens on the moon. And I was just like really impressed by how fast this was going.
The pacing is again like it's a very faithful adaptation. Like this is only like a 200-page book.
Oh
so
wow!
So we really do just motor through.
Like they get to the fun so fast. It's great. After kind of this forced dream that causes aliens to invade the moon, George sort of disappears. He's like, "That's it. We're done with dreaming.
Mm-hmm.
No more.
This is my breaking point."
And Lalash goes to try to track him down because obviously she remembers this plague he brought to this world. And of course, she can't find George at his much nicer and, as you said, Jordan, much less crowded apartment building.
Mm-hmm.
But thankfully, his nosy neighbor's like, he's probably at his government lottery cabin. I'd head out there.
Do you think he was jealous of that government lottery cabin?
100%.
Yeah.
If your neighbor won the government lottery... be so mad.
I don't know if this is clear in the movie, but he's the landlord.
Oh, really?
So he's got that whole building if he wants it.
Yeah, but he's not renting them out.
That's true.
Oh, man. So she heads out to basically this oceanfront view of this cottage, and she basically she remembers the plague happening, and when she goes to find George, she's just like, oh, BTW, aliens on the moon? That was me too. She's like, makes sense. I should have thought of that.
Yeah.
But she basically is like, I want to help you, and I've got an idea. I've seen hypnosis done before. I've witnessed it happen in front of me.
I could do it.
So I don't see why I can't just hypnotize you. So why don't I hypnotize you and suggest that you dream of nothing? And I was like, oh, good. He's going to dream about Seinfeld now. Which this actor was on Seinfeld playing the chairman of the Susan Ross Foundation. So I'm like, in this dream, it's just the entirety of Seinfeld plays in his mind.
Yeah.
But no.
He's also the gooey guy from X-Men too, right?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. He's in so... I went through his IMDb. It is crazy. I literally last night, I watched an episode of Star Trek Enterprise. He was in it. He was just in the episode I watched last night.
He's great.
He's got like 1,000 credits. I actually remembered him most from when I was a kid. He was George Henderson in the TV version of Harry and the Hendersons.
Aww.
Yeah.
That's a great part for him.
Absolutely. I was looking at that too. He's doing Harry and the Hendersons at the same time he's doing a Robert Altman movie.
What a career.
This guy's career is out of control. At any rate, so she puts him into a hypnosis state because she's seen it happen before. And as she's about to suggest the nothing dream, she kind of panics, which fair enough. She's like, oh, how's the subconscious going to interpret nothing if this is how he interprets world peace? So she pulls back and she's like, hey, what about you just have a really nice dream where everything's okay? And the aliens left the moon. George wakes up, aliens have left the moon and they're now invading Earth.
Yeah. He's a literal guy.
You got to be real careful what you tell this man.
I do like, though, that she she was actually there to witness Haber doing the dream and saw that there's problems and still thought, I bet I could do better.
I'm going to throw this in.
Yeah, but she did exactly what Haber did. It's just like she wasn't any more specific.
Yeah, I mean, she took a swing, but she didn't think it out before she got there.
Yeah.
Well, and it's just sort of like, it is, I think she's panicking because she starts by saying, Haber is going to be honest with you and he's going to be straight with you and you're going to be able to work with him and he's going to be well-intentioned. And then she just sort of slips in right at the end, like, oh, and the aliens are off the moon.
Oh, what did I come in here for? All right, aliens. Yeah, they're gone.
At any rate, they hop in her boxy little smart car she drives, which I thought was quite cute. And head off to see Dr. Haber, because I guess, is that it? I don't remember this happening in the movie, but maybe it did, because they're like, let's go to Haber. We're going to have to help get him to help us fix this. And I was a little bit like, I mean, I get he's the only person you can go talk to about this stuff, but is the idea that like she attempted to like fix Haber in the dream as well?
I think it's a little bit of that and a little bit of just they don't know what else to do.
Yeah, things are getting way out of control now.
Something has got to be done.
Because the aliens are invading. Apparently, they have the technology to abort their mission, their missile control system, so the missiles aren't working. They're out of options.
Yeah.
And they get back to Haber's office. He's really updated this dream machine in the meantime, because now you don't gonna have to get chokeholded anymore. He just pushes a button and you're automatically hypnotized now.
It is interesting to note, though, at the very first time we see George go into Haber's office, I think the dream machine was just essentially a couch with two, like, glass bowls over his head, and then it became, like, a big headset. Then it's, like, now, like, a tiara. And I think at the end, he doesn't even need to have anything. He's just like, yeah you're in a dream. A
weird dome by the end you get into.
Yeah.
But yes, this time, they knock him out. Haber's dream suggestion is, hey, stop the invasion in your dream, and you know what? Everybody is at peace now. This is the dream. Have those two thoughts in your dream this time. And while George dreams, an alien materializes behind Dr. Haber and informs him in his dulcet tones, hey, we're not a hostile race. We're only here to seek a peaceful coexistence. To which Haber says, I'm not really the guy you got to talk to about ending the war. You've kind of come to the wrong place. And the alien very politely excuses itself.
It just shuffles
Pardon
out of the room.
Interruption.
It's like, oh, my bad, sir. I'll go talk to the president. Nice to meet you, though.
Yeah.
But essentially the idea being the war has ended. The aliens are just here to hang out and like live with among us very peacefully. And George wakes up and is explained that like, what's happened, and I really like this. George just starts laughing. He's like, it's just a friendly invasion. He finds this all hilarious now. Yeah. He's just like really enjoying the insanity every time he wakes up.
Yeah, at this point, George is like almost flippant about it. Like, he's just like, just an alien. Nice guy. You talk to him.
Yeah, friendly invasion. What more could you ask for? And then he leaves with Lalash and they head down to the Haber Institute's lunchroom where they go to get some turbo fish for lunch.
Oh, it's my favorite line in the entire movie. Just apropos of nothing, they're eating, he's like, God, I hate turbo fish.
I know, right? So good. But lunch is interrupted when Dr. Haber comes down with some goons because he's just like, yo, George, I'm very close to curing you of effective dreaming. I've isolated it on this 12 seconds of brain activity, I guess, where your dreams rewrite reality. So I'm just going to haul you back up to my newer ominous dream machine. It's even scarier than before. I'm going to hypnotize you again, and we're going to see if we can, like, fix all of these problems. I'm not going to learn any lessons from anything that's happened. We're still doing this.
And it's the room is almost like a surgery theater now at this point.
Yeah, it gets more and more epic every time he goes to this dream machine. And they put George back under into hypnosis state, and one of the assistants is looking at the machines and informs him that, like, they're having trouble, I guess, doing whatever this machine's supposed to do, I guess, to remove the effect of dreaming because George is resisting it inside the dream. And I only mention this because this is my favorite part, because Haber's so frustrated. He just really wants to force the effect of dreaming out of George into his machine. And I believe he gets so mad, he's just like, oh, this man and his stupid chicken brain. And I just loved how mad he was. And he's just like, chicken brain. I'm like, interesting.
I don't know if it's in this exact moment, but there's like a screen, and I think the word like resisting flashes up, so yeah. We know
the computers do the work for the movie where they just, it keeps telling you what's happening. It's like, yeah, he's in a dream now. Dream problems.
I did like that too, when you see him going into dream states, like they're like, we have to wait till you get to REM sleep, and like you just see a computer just like, sleep stage 1, 2, 3, 4. I'm like, I guess 4 is REM sleep. Like it just counts down for you. Thanks machine. But yes, at this moment, we go into George's dream, and we kind of get a really strange dream sequence where an alien appears to him. And I guess this is an attempt to kind of give a little bit of exposition as to what's happening. I'm sure this is directly from the book, and you can fill me in. But, like, essentially, the alien is telling George kind of, you can only control this power at the source, and that, like, people who have this power, the aliens call them sons of heaven because I guess they see it as something from the ability to change, I guess, reality as a god. And then this is where the title comes up is the alien says that people who are unable to understand the power will be destroyed on the Lathe of Heaven. And it's all very existential and mysterious, but I guess this is kind of where it's talking about this idea of, like, George either needs to lock in how to control this, or he in reality will be just, like, torn asunder, I guess, is basically what's supposed to be come out of this very existential, mysterious dream.
Yeah, there's some, and I'm not going to try and say who it's from, that quote, because I'll misquote it, but it is like a Taoist quote, which is, you can see sort of in a lot of Ursula's work, is that the universe has a balance and people shouldn't upset that balance.
Okay, that makes sense. Yeah, I mean, I got that from this. It's interesting because as we get into this latter half of the movie, we're getting into the more esoteric ideas and things happening in the mind of the dreamscape that becomes harder and harder to visualize. So there's a bit more open to interpretation stuff that starts happening, which I liked, but it's interesting. Like, I have to think about these scenes after I watch them and be like, what did that mean? Where are we going with that?
And there is sort of the suggestion that, like, the aliens have a name for what it is that George can do.
Okay.
And so it's kind of, I guess it's open to interpretation. Like, is this a thing that happens in the universe?
Yeah, the idea that maybe other people have it as well, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. At any rate, while George is kind of having this dream where we're kind of getting a bit of exposition, Dr. Haber does have a suggestion for how to help the world again. So he gives George a suggestion, something to dream about. And this time he says, hey, why don't you dream about ending racism? Which was great, because when George wakes up, how he's ended racism is like a Twilight Zone episode come to life.
Yeah.
It is funny, though, because if this had a different tone, this is almost like a broad comedy. You're asking someone to do something and they get so literally that hilarious results come from everything. But yeah, he says to him, stop racism, so then everyone's gray. Like, literally gray.
They've painted every single actor, and there's huge crowd scenes where they painted everyone gray, peppered everyone's hair white. Honestly, for a moment, I thought this was the end of the movie. It felt like such a Twilight Zone ending. I was like, if this was a Twilight Zone episode, this is where it would stop, basically.
Yeah.
But Haber loves it. He's like, oh, finally, all I've been asking for is gray people this whole time.
Perfect. Pitch perfect this time, George. You nailed it.
Thanks a lot, chicken brain.
Exactly.
Which I like, kind of found this very interesting because, like, I'm sort of interpreting what's happening here is every time they go into this more upgraded dream machine, Dr. Haber seems to be getting closer and closer to his solution to what he wants to happen. So now that everyone's gray, which he's very happy about, he informs George that, like, this time, this next dream, he's actually going to be able to cure him of his problem. He's going to be able to end effective dreaming, essentially by asking George to dream that he no longer can effective dream. That's the solution. But like the subtext is that he's built the machine big enough to absorb the power of effective dreaming. So basically he can just, Dr. Hable will remove George from the situation. Mm-hmm. Dr. Hable will take over effective dreaming, fix the world properly. And George is interesting here because at this point, it seems like George has given up. Like he's just like, he doesn't care he's going to be cured. He doesn't care what Dr. Haber does. Like, he is so nonplussed about everything. I was just like, this is an interesting point for this character.
He is, like, generally a pretty passive guy. Like, you do sort of think as he's going through the motions and realizing how out of control Haber's getting, I think our brains are so wired to the hero is going to do something that you do sort of keep waiting for, like, well, George, I'm sure, has got a plan for how to handle this, but he doesn't.
Oh, absolutely not. He is just like, I do not care anymore.
George just wants a good night's sleep.
Yeah, exactly. 100%.
And so he gets taken up to Dr. Haber's newest dream machine, which is a huge dome on the top of a tower that you have to take an elevator to get to.
He calls it Haber's Palace of Dreams.
Yes, that's right.
Aww.
Amazing piece of location work they found here. This, like, crazy, like, 20-story tower with a huge dome on top. I was like, this is insane. But essentially, George is now put to sleep, cured of effective dreaming, and the power to effective dream has been moved to Haber's Palace of Dreams, which I believe he says he'll be able to fix the world in about 6 weeks or so.
It's on his flowchart. He's like, actually, yeah, 6 weeks.
He mapped it out.
For George, though, there has been a change to the reality since all this new dreaming to end racism and fix himself has happened. Heather LaLache is missing. She just doesn't seem to exist in this reality anymore. And sort of this new passive, sort of lost George wanders into a local junk shop he happens to be walking by, which we finally come back to the aliens, which Dr. Haber has implied are still on Earth because he's very insistent he's going to get rid of these aliens first.
He's annoyed about it, yeah.
He wants world peace, but God, he got to get rid of these aliens. He just does not care to see them around. They're not welcome where he is. But this junk shop happens to be owned and operated by one of these crazy aliens who moved. They just settled right in. They opened junk shops. He's just selling some antiques. I believe later we'll find out this really chill alien. His name is, let me see if I can pronounce this, Eminemanasa.
Very good.
I was really hoping we were going to see the alien stalk the shelves because it moves. It has almost no mobility, but we don't get to see that. He just stays behind the counter.
It's kind of got one arm that he's able to move. The rest of him is like just like this beetle husk that can't move anywhere.
I think, I don't know if it's clear in this, but like in the book, it's suggested that that's a suit.
Right.
And we never see what's under it.
I got the sense that might be the case. It was whatever it was very.
He might have great abs under there, is what you're saying.
Oh yeah, he's very lithe.
So George is just poking around this junk shop, talking to this friendly alien, and just sort of saying he's sort of lamenting the loss of Heather, and kind of her being missing. And the alien is very helpful. He recommends, hey, if you can't find your friend, like I said, I've got a suggestion for you. Take this vinyl single of the Beatles with a little help from your friends. That might help you find her.
I mean, yeah.
And he goes home, has a little nap, puts his record on, and he falls into a deep dream of the ocean's waves and having sex with Heather.
Yes.
And at the end of this dream, she emerges from the ocean again. And when he wakes, she's back. They're in bed together. And she's his wife now.
So all that practice with his aunt paid off, huh?
I forgot to, when he dreams the aliens, I think it's worth mentioning, we get this shot of George naked for some
reason.
That's true.
He's him and a turtle swimming around naked.
Yeah, like, people are naked in his dreams.
Why? We've seen this in other shows too, where if you go into a dream world, you gotta be naked. Remember Earth 2, Jordan?
Yeah. Your clothes can't come along.
At any rate, Heather's returned. And actually, like, people's races have returned after this dream, too. She, like, they're all out of Gray World. They're all back to their original race now. And this is never explicitly stated, but my understanding from this whole thing is the alien was able to help George restore his effective dreaming by kind of, I guess, because he's a creation of George anyway. He's like, if you go home and listen to this and you like want it bad enough, like your effective dreaming has just been suppressed. It hasn't been removed from you. You can return it to you and bring these things back if you want them. That's how I interpreted it anyway.
I think that's right. I mean, he sort of mentions in the book like that it makes sense that the aliens would be on his side because he brought them here in the first place. So
he's their daddy.
It is. Yeah. And he says to the alien that he, you know, he's looking for Heather and he's like, well, here.
Let me help you out.
Like, well, he helped the aliens out with their like small business loans to open those antique shops and stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
But now that Heather's back, though, there's still trouble brewing because back at Dr. Haber's lab, he's entering this dream augmenter in the dream palace or whatever, and he's preparing himself to like finally use effective dreaming himself and rewrite reality. And as this is sort of happening across town, like George just gets this sense. There's just something in the wind, the way the air is moving, that something is very wrong. And he and Lathe start racing back to Dr. Haber's lab. And as he does, George explains sort of why he can feel there's something wrong in the air. And he sort of tells her that 4 years ago, there was a nuclear war. And like Portland itself was hit by a huge nuclear blast, which is kind of what we saw at the beginning of this movie. It's like him wandering the ruins of the city. And he was dying of radiation poisoning. And as he was dying, he had a dream that he was alive, which I guess basically the start of this movie is the, like, world he recreated for himself. Mm-hmm. So he returned to this world after nuclear war via a dream that rewrote reality. And we saw a glimpse of that at the beginning of the movie. And my understanding is like he's seen reality torn asunder or nearly destroyed in this nuclear war. And now that whatever Dr. Haber's doing is threatening to tear reality apart again, that's why he can sense it in the world. That was my interpretation. It's like he can feel this like reality destroying apocalypse on its way again.
Isn't that really his worry through the whole thing, is that every time it changes it might come one step closer to this destruction that already happened? And he knows that if Haber keeps having these grand visions, it's just like instead of small steps there are huge leaps towards this eventual destruction no matter what you try to do.
Yeah And it was interesting, like this is where the motivations get a little more like interpretive, I think, but like I was on board. I was like, let's get there, we gotta stop Haber now.
There's sort of the sense from George that the world that ended was true, and that everything that has happened since is only being held together by the fabric of George's mind.
It's interesting. I also thought I was maybe a reveal this has all been a dream for a second. They didn't go that way. Like they do establish this as reality. But like, yeah, there is this idea that George's mind is holding things together.
We should say, though, Haber has a great looking bed, though, that he goes into. It's like a light bed that has an actual his body shape. Like he's had it designed so only he can lay in the bed.
I also want to mention, now that we're talking about it, because you mentioned his sweater at the beginning, and the way that Haber's wardrobe changes in the film, I think is so nicely done. He just gets these like slightly better fitting, they're like suits, but they're like quilted.
Yeah.
And they look very cozy, but he looks good.
No, I agree. He looks good. It's like he's got a little makeover along with world peace. You can have both.
Why not? Why not make the world better and just a little better fashion sense?
Yeah.
I mean, there's also some hints of a little bit of fascism also happening, because like, I'm sure you noticed like the people who were his, not doctors, but people that were working in the facility who had lab coats, they're suddenly now wearing militaristic outfits and things like that are changing. So I think there's supposed to be this hint of authoritarian isn't always the way to go.
Yeah, I mean, it's Dr. Haber's reality or the highway, my friend.
Well, he doesn't want any of these chicken brain people taken over.
But as they're getting to Dr. Haber's lab to stop him, like, they have this effect of like the ground has started to split open and we get like stock footage of volcanoes exploding. Like it does seem like the world is in fact tearing itself asunder. And George enters into the lab and we kind of enter sort of a psychic dreamscape here. This is where it gets the probably most interpretive of it, where it's interesting. Like it's all done. I don't know if you guys know this artist. There's an artist named Anthony McCall who he creates light sculptures, which is what he'll do is he'll take a projector and like focus the light into just a cone in a black room, and then he smokes the room out so that the beams of light that exist are now take a physical form. Like, so you're like in a tube of light, or you're in a star of light, or like you can interact with it. And that's very much what this dreamscape looks like, is it's a cone of light that's all blue and like hazy. And it, you know, I think we've seen it in other sci-fi shows, but it's a cheap, effective way to show like another world kind of thing. And Haber seems very lost in this like light cone. He doesn't know where he's going. He seems overwhelmed. We see weird hands reaching out of the ether to grab at him.
I liked it. I thought it was a great way to show like a dream sequence. I thought it's something that the show did really, really effective, was show that sort of otherworld feel of having a dream.
Yeah, and George is able to enter this world and sort of pull Haber out of it, and I guess saving reality. Like, the entire sequence sort of ends with George grabbing Haber out, and then you see a hand sort of close on a beam of light, like crushing it out of existence. And then from this, like, very interpretive dream sequence, we hard cut, and George, he's back at that junk shop, but in this reality, he works there. His boss is Eminem and Asa. They're hanging out. They're having a nice time.
They're best friends.
Him and this alien just run this junk store together. And, into that junk store walks Heather LaLash, and in this new reality, they've never met. She doesn't remember him. They've never had contact before. But, you know, he tells her, "You helped me once. You're a great civil liberties lawyer. You really helped me one time. Can I buy you lunch, and can we restart our romance from scratch?" Very nice. Mm-hmm. Very nice. Mm-hmm. And on their way to lunch, they happen to walk past a nurse out for a stroll with their patient in a wheelchair, and it's old Dr. Haber. And he's catatonic now and looking quite worse for the wear.
Why is he catatonic, though?
So I think this is like maybe a pacing thing, because we do just sort of rush to the end here. And the suggestion, like in the book, first of all, he doesn't just find him in the street. Dr. Haber is at an institute and he goes to see him. Mm. And the idea is that Haber has seen sort of the reality of George and everything that he's done, and he's seen 1998, which is when the nuclear war happened, and his brain is basically destroyed by the knowledge that the world they're in either like isn't necessarily real, or just like the horror of everything that George has been through, and it's just too much and it breaks his brain.
Yeah, that's sort of how it's interpreted here too. I believe they sort of talk about how he's seen, they call it April 4th in the movie, like that's when the nuclear war happened. So he's like seen the world after April 4th. So it's sort of just broken his brain. And what's kind of interesting too is like as they're walking through the city too, you still see like the cracks in the street we saw as the world was tearing itself apart. So like it's interesting to see that this reality hasn't fixed itself entirely. There's still scars from when Haber nearly destroyed reality.
For sure. And the hand, I think, that hits the orb that we're seeing here is that's George destroying the augmenter.
Ah, yes, yes, yes. That makes sense.
So the idea, and George has lost his ability to effective dream. And I think even in the timeline of the book, the dream that George has with LaLash is before he's given the instructions by Haber that he's cured.
Oh, interesting.
So it's a little bit more clear that like George no longer has the ability to change this world, and neither does anybody else.
Right, he destroys it all in this moment. Yeah, it's not quite as explicit in the movie for sure.
He really should have done that after everyone was gray, because they still got racism.
Yes, he should have kept that one thing that everybody liked.
But we get to kind of see a wrap up for Dr. Haber. These two are getting back together, and my got to be one of my favorite parts of the movie is they go and have lunch, and they buy a street hot dog from one of those little alien cocoons who just runs a hot dog cart, and the credits run. They're just like sitting on kind of not a bench, but they're sort of sitting over like a nice water feature. And in the background is this alien just waving its arm up and down, selling hot dogs.
Loving his job.
He's just so happy. I truly have never been happier as watching those credits of that little alien just hawking hot dogs behind them.
It's an interesting thing, too, with how fast we go through it. Because one thing I think that you lose in the book is that, like, Heather is everything to George.
Right.
Like, Heather is the love of his life. She is the only thing in this earth that he really cares about. And, like, when he destroys the augmenter, he thinks he's lost her forever. He thinks he's never going to see her again. And like his parents are gone. Because they've still died in the plague in this reality. Like George is a man who has nothing, and he has to like really sit with that loss. And in this, it's like he destroys the augmenter, and then cut to Heather being like, "Can I have that egg whisk?"
Antique egg whisk, yes please.
I have to say though, I like though she has it. He's like, "Do you want that?" And she goes, "No,
no, I just wanted to see it."
It's like any junk shop. You're not gonna buy anything in there. You're just poking around.
I'm like, I'm just wasting time in here.
Yeah, I was just being polite, so I pretended I was interested.
I mean, this kind of brings us, I guess, to some final notes on this. But like, Hilary, like, you obviously, as our expert, have read the book a couple times, and you've seen this. Like, how's the adaptation? Is it like a decent adaptation?
I think it's really well done. Like, I think it's a huge book. And like when I first read the book and I didn't know that this movie existed, I was thinking like, oh, if somebody was going to adapt this, it's going to have to be like Christopher Nolan.
Right.
Like this is going to be the most expensive movie ever made because it's so high concept. Like that ending scene in the book, Mount Hood erupts.
Right.
And Portland is melting and it's like the buildings are collapsing around them. And it's so high concept. So for them to be able to have done this with the budget they had, I think is amazing.
It seems that most people have a very positive feeling about this movie. Like, apparently people were really wanting to see this for years and years and hadn't been able till it was on DVD. I should mention, though, it was remade again in 2002 with James Caan.
I was going to say the same
thing. And Lisa Bonet, and it looks terrible.
Yeah, when I found that, too, I'm like, wow, those must be stark contrasts, these two movies.
For sure. And this is, Ursula has said herself that this is the only adaptation of her work she thinks is any good.
I mean, she's had some bad misses, I think.
She had some bad misses. Even, I think, what's the Miyazaki one, right?
Yeah, well, that Earth, the one you read, or Earthsea.
Yeah, she said that Miyazaki could make an adaptation of that after she saw Spirited Away. And then he let his son direct it.
Yeah.
And she was like, that's not what I signed up for at all.
My son can probably do it, right? No, yeah. The answer is no. Yeah, I mean, it's interesting to hear kind of that it was surprising to me. I was surprised to see how interesting and like complicated, like the book clearly, yeah. I can imagine how much more detailed it is, but like seeing these two like video artists take $250,000 in 1979 and be like, all right, we can probably do this and do a pretty good job of it, actually.
Do a pretty good job. And I think, to be honest, like some of where it suffers is that it is such a straight adaptation. Which is probably why Ursula liked it so much. Just only in that what I mentioned, like with Heather, like so much of the book is internal.
Right.
That in doing such a straight adaptation, I do feel like you lose a bit of that, sort of the struggle of Orr. Like even the moment when he is being so flippant, like, yeah, well, this is the world we live in now, whatever. Like this is a man who is tortured.
Well, I mean, this is probably a good time. Then, like, Hilary, typically we rate things out of 10 stars, very much like IMDb scale. What do you think? What do you want to rate The Lathe of Heaven?
So I've been thinking about this, and I don't know if this is going to come in high or low compared to... I think it'll be... I know, Jordan, you're generous.
Well, it depends. Depends what it is.
But I think they did an amazing job. Like, I enjoyed watching it. I think the casting is really good. I think... they were super creative in their choices, and I'm going to give it an 8.
An 8. Great. Why don't I go next? We watch a lot of stuff on this podcast, and this was, for us on this podcast, a real treat, I have to say. And I think, you know, there's some challenges in the translation. I think in that back half, it's a little more open to interpretation, maybe because it gets a little nebulous. It's tough to read character motivations a little bit. Mm-hmm. But I got to say, watching this, I was like, I was blown. Like, it feels like a cult movie that I have never heard of before. And
totally.
Like, is great and interesting and really stuck with me. I'm going to go 9.5. I'm going to withhold 0.5 because it does get a little choppy in the end, but in the end, like, I liked it still. Like, I liked how choppy it was because it made me think about it more and try to like interpret where it was, what the thoughts were. I'm gonna go all the way. I'm gonna go 9.5.
I love that.
I'm gonna go pretty good too. I think this is probably, if not our highest rated, one of them. I'm gonna also give it an 8 out of 10. It has some low production value, there's no question. This is not gonna be, you know, this was never meant to be on the big screen, and it doesn't wow you with any special effects or anything, but I think the ideas come across, and I think they found really inventive ways to take big ideas and scale them down without you really noticing them. And I just think it was just a well done production. And that could just be also compared to some of the crap we've had to watch. And I think this was just really well done for what it was. So 8 out of 10.
8 out of 10. Yes. What a real winner.
Mm-hmm. Before we move too far away from it too, I would be remiss if I didn't mention something I found out this morning when I was looking to see who did this adaptation and if I knew anything else that they had done. Did you catch that Diane English, who did the adapted screenplay, is the creator of Murphy Brown?
No,
I didn't.
So she's had a great career.
That's incredible. From the creator of Murphy Brown.
Yeah.
The Lathe of Heaven. I like that. I like that a lot.
Murphy Brown.
I was excited.
Well, I think that about wraps it up for this episode. Hilary, thank you so much for joining us to talk about this. Your expertise were very helpful.
My pleasure.
It was a real treat. And listener, if you want to see some little clips of this, if you want to see what we're talking about for Lathe of Heaven, you can follow us on Instagram and Twitter at Continuum Drag. We'll have some clips from the show up there. Definitely that little alien hawk and hot dogs.
Yeah, that's in there.
That's a gift.
And of course, if you want to contact us by email, our email here is continuumdrag@gmail.com. But that wraps it up for this episode. So listener, thank you for joining us. And Jordan, I'll see you next week.
Antwerp.
Continuum Drag is recorded in Toronto, Ontario. Theme music by James Rex Seidler. Produced by Jordan Dulick and Luke Black. Special thanks to Aaron Hughes.